April 18th, 1991 was the day the dream came true for Trixter. It was the first time we got to play the great Meadowlands Arena in East Rutherford, New Jersey. It's 30 years later, so looking back on it, definitely can say it was one of the greatest nights of my life.
Wow, we are celebrating the 30th anniversary of the first time Trixter played the Meadowlands Arena in New Jersey. And the best thing about that night was not only were we playing our hometown arena for the first time and on an upward trajectory of our career, but we were getting our gold records that night too. And we threw in a big party at a private room upstairs in the Meadowlands.
Playing the greatest arena in our hometown, home county. Place where we saw Kiss, Van Halen, Bon Jovi, Def Leppard, Aerosmith, AC/DC, Judas Priest, Whitesnake.
Jefferson, who we call you are!
It was Bon Jovi. They were the first hard rock band really to play the Meadowlands Arena from New Jersey. Then Skid Row, we were all there when Skid Row played in 89, opened up for Bon Jovi, and that was our turn, 1991, man.
Anytime we got a tour schedule, always look down the list. East Rutherford, anywhere. So I remember the first time we did see it on itinerary, we went nuts.
It was everything that we had ever wanted to do with our lives. When I started the band back in 1983, me and the guys, that's all we ever talked about was playing the Meadowlands Arena. We finally got to do it on April 18th, 1991. Show itself was just, it was kind of, you know, we'd been playing arenas for about 2 months at that point. So by the time we got to the Meadowlands, we were a well-oiled machine. We were used to playing. We'd been on tour with the Scorpions for like 2 months. We did a week or so with Poison back in February of 91. And so by the time we got there, we were ready to go. And I just remember getting out there with the intro and the crowd going nuts and knowing that, you know, my mom and dad, my brothers, everybody and all our friends and family were out there, all the fans from day one. You know, going crazy. And I remember just ripping into Bad Girl and looking over at Pete and PJ going, yeah, this is gonna be awesome. And it was, you know, we had a great show.
Yeah.
You know, for us, it was never about getting a record deal. It was never about selling a million records, making MTV videos, being on the covers of magazines, going on tour. When we were young, and I'm gonna say probably from 1984 to 1986, 87, it was just all about, we always said, if we play the Meadowlands Arena, Brendan Byrne Arena, our career is done. We'll be the happiest guys in the world. And it was kind of true. You know, we learned later on how important all the other things were, like getting a record deal, because it's very hard to play arenas without having a record deal. So we learned about all those cool things. For me, the song of the night definitely was On and On. You know, we did that towards the end of the set. And that was the song that, you know, kind of summed up our whole story and my whole story, you know, since I was a young boy, always knew what I wanted to be. And to play On and On at the Meadowlands Arena, got up there with my double neck guitar and ripped into it. And I remember, man, it was everything that I had worked for all my life. You know, the 20,000 hours of work, writing songs and practicing my guitar, wanting to be Eddie Van Halen, wanting to be Bon Jovi, Def Leppard, Kiss, was all that wrapped up in that one song. And I remember by the time I got to the chorus, you know, and I started belting out the guitar with the chorus, I started getting choked up a little bit. That was very emotional because I knew my mom and dad were out there, my brothers, all the fans that were there from day one, you know, that saw us when we played our first shows in Paramus, New Jersey at Eastbrook Middle School or the Band Shell or the Paramus Roller Rink through the China Club Studio One. Here we were, you know.
So it was just amazing, surreal moment. The show went like that, of course. And I remember in the dressing room before, we were goofing around with each other going, hey, what are you doing tonight? Oh, playing the Meadowlands? Cool. Always wanted to say that. With the Scorpions for about a month or so, maybe before that date, and we had a day off. I remember we all got to go home and sleep in our own beds, and I had bunk beds in my room that I shared with my brother. I remember trying to sleep in the top bunk the night before, staring at the ceiling going, this is crazy. Next day, my brother and I drive to the arena in his big yellow Thunderbird, and realizing what a different experience it is driving there, being part of the show and not just going to a concert, dealing with parking and, you know, getting your tickets, a will call if you didn't have them yet, and lines and all that stuff. Meanwhile, we just drove a beat up Thunderbird through the gate, right back stage, walked down the loading dock, right into the building.
Looking back on it, I remember the day of the show. I remember going there early for soundcheck with my mom, my sister-in-law, Marianne, and my niece and nephew, Katie and Mike Jr. And we were walking around the arena before we did sound check, and I remember just going up and down with the kids. You know, my niece and nephew were young, and we were walking up and down, and I just kept looking around, like looking up at the ceiling, going, man, this is, I can't believe I'm finally gonna play here tonight. You know, this is where I saw Van Halen play in 1984. That was the first concert I ever saw at the Meadowlands, was Van Halen 1984 tour. So I was thinking, I'm gonna get to do scissor kicks on the same stage that Eddie Van Halen got to do his, you know, a couple years earlier. So the show kind of flew by, and we had a great show, and you know, just, I remember getting backstage, and we had to rush because we had to go to the upstairs, to the winner's circle, I think it was called, or whatever, for our after party, where the record company and our management and everybody was presenting us with our gold records. And I remember
after our show, we went upstairs, and MTV presented us with our gold record awards, and then we partied on through the night. Tom Araya from Slayer was there. I mean, you know, it was a mixed bag of people there. It was awesome. It was unbelievable. It was like, what the hell is going on? How did we get here? How did we get here?
This man, when they handed that record to me, which is right there, that's the original one, I was just like, this is just the greatest day in my life. You ask PJ or Pete, you know, they tell you the same thing. Man, it's still, I'm actually getting like choked up talking about it.
Yeah, really.
What are you missing, Goose?
My shirt and my
shoes. Jewelry back on. Because they're about to go to the gold record party at the Winners Club.
Oh, notice it.
Gold. I don't, is this kind
of... That night that we got our gold records, you know, we had Doc McGee was managing the Scorpions, who managed Bon Jovi back then. So it was really celebratory to be able to say to Doc, you know, hey man, we're getting our gold records like you guys did 6 years earlier with Bon Jovi. And, you know, Tico and Alec were there with us, and the Scorpions, of course, opening up for them. It was a dream come true. And it was just surreal. It was just great, man. But one of the shows that had, I think, the biggest impact on all of us, because we were all there, was Rat Bon Jovi 1985. Bon Jovi was opening up for Rat. And we were there, and that was my first time seeing Bon Jovi. I think all of us, you know, PJ, Pete, seeing Bon Jovi for the first time, and they were just on fire, man. And I remember Mark Goodman, I believe it was, from MTV, came out, and he said, we're gonna present Bon Jovi with their first gold record. And I remember, I think I looked at Pete, and Jim DeSalvo was with us, God rest his soul, he was with us, and we're all, and I kind of looked at everybody, I said, man, someday that's gonna be us.
On behalf of Mercury Polygram Records, this is just the first 500,000. Congratulations. This gold record is for you guys, you know? Because when everybody forgot about us, we could always come home to Jersey and play for you guys. Thank you.
Now, 6 years later, it was. Some of the other cool moments I remember is getting there and, you know, we used to sneak backstage, me and the Trixter guys, we used to sneak backstage to all the shows back then, because it was like, fake it till you make it, you know, act like you belong and you belong. And we learned, I believe Sug, our drummer, he worked a show, I think the David Lee Roth show in 1986, and he found that section 110, there's a doorway that goes from the arena to the backstage area, and he told us about that. So every show we went to, we were backstage, we knew all the stage hands, we knew all the security guards. We never had passes, or very few times did we ever have passes.
And we used to sneak downstairs into the dressing room area, any show we went to. We knew the trap door. So we knew the layout backstage over there already. We've been there a bunch of times. So it was like, ooh, I wonder what dressing room we're gonna get. And it was just funny being able to be back there and not worry about getting kicked out. And we saw some of the local crew that we had known.
It was incredible to finally be there, you know, and be legit. Like, yeah, we're finally playing here, and seeing all the local guys that we knew since we were young kids going, and everybody was so proud for us. You know, I remember saying to one of the security guards, hey, showing him my laminate going, hey man, I finally got a backstage pass this time. Yeah, it was something else. Meadowlands in the dressing room, like real rock stars do, with Tico and Alec from Bon Jovi, the Tesla guys were there, the Bullet Boys were all, everybody's drinking and partying in the dressing room.
There's just so many people there. Our dressing room was packed with people. from Bon Jovi people and Tesla and God, I mean, you couldn't fit any more people in our dressing room. I have footage of it, and you open the door, you're like, oh, get out, can't even fit a camera in there. And the cameras were huge back then.
Yeah, the MTV Week in Rock caught that. And that was really cool. I wasn't there for that, but I got to see the pictures, which was really neat.
For a metal show like this, you gotta wonder what's going on backstage.
I had to hurry up and get out of there because my mom was having a big party. My mom and dad were having a big party at the Paramus house. We were having a big party with all the neighbors, all the friends, whoever couldn't, you know, get backstage, you know, at the Meadowlands. They all came back to my mom and dad's house. And I remember my cousin Vinny, my wife's cousin Vinny, Cosette's cousin, she made us he made us this awesome cake, this Trixter cake. And it was just a great night. And I remember Bill Ray and Jim Ray, our producers on the first record, and Brian and a couple of our engineers from the record came back to my mom and dad's house. And it was just, you know, a really cool, chill way to cap off this unbelievable night. And I remember also Doc McGee had the Scorpions. I had this guitar that my brother Chris painted for me. Doc McGee got the Scorpions guys to sign it for me before the show, so I didn't have to travel with it. So that's really cool. I think you can see that. This is the 1991 Scorpions band. Very cool. See, what else do I have here? Oh, this is a really cool thing. So you'll dig this. October 10th, 1986. We were all there when David Lee Roth played the Meadowlands. I believe it was on his birthday. I was there with Pete and Jim, and I guess Gus was there, and PJ. PJ wasn't even in the band yet, but I think everybody in New Jersey, every rock fan was at this show. David Lee Roth, and somebody made this banner, and we found it in the parking lot. And this was always hanging in the basement of my parents' house where we used to rehearse in Paramus. And I remember, and I've kept it all these years, and it's a great memory of an incredible time, you know? And it's sad to think that the Meadowlands isn't even open anymore, but still got this.
You know how to kick some fucking ass!
Easily one of the greatest nights of my life and my musical career. And I think, you know, again, the other guys would say the same thing.
But it was a remarkable evening. I'll never forget it. And I do remember that Steve got a flat tire in the parking lot. Some things never change. So that was funny. Not for him, but for me.
So I think, you know, looking back on it, one of the biggest, the coolest things was getting our gold records that night as well. Getting our gold records, playing the Meadowlands Arena, and getting our gold records with all our friends and family there, big party and everything. It was really cool. And it was just, you know, overall, it was everything that you could ever dream of, you know. And again, like I said, that was the dream come true, really. And if it all ended right there, that was our goal from when, you know, when we got going with the band back in 1983, 84. It was all about playing the Meadowlands Arena.
You did it.
How was it being back in your hometown?
I think I peed in my pants twice, and I don't know. It was great.
Was it what you expected?
Awesome. We're going to Disneyland.
Awesome.
We're going to Wally World, all right? And you're invited.
I will never jump again.
I will never, ever, ever jump again.
Thanks for listening to my recollection and participating in the celebration of a day that will forever be huge in trickstery. All right.
And there you have it. 30 years later, April 18th, 1991. It's April 18th, 2021. Still in this crazy pandemic, but looking back on that night, it was something else. Trixter, Meadowlands Arena, East Rutherford, New Jersey. The dream come true.